Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to aetuts.com. And hopefully we're going to have a good time doing some cool visual effects and all that jazz. Today I'm bringing you, rather than bringing you a tutorial where I've gone out and filmed something specifically to show you how to do something, I'm actually going to use a real-world project, something I actually worked on, which was a pitch trailer for a new television show called Vampire Zoo, which, whilst it has a pretty awful name, was a really, really interesting project to work on. I served as director of photography and lighting, editor, visual effects artist, and color grader on the trailer, and I'm going to share with you hopefully a couple of tutorials on some of the stuff that we did. Remember, this is real world stuff. This is stuff where a director sat me down and said, right, this is what we want, can we do this? And I had to say yes we can and figure out exactly how it was done. And the first thing I want to show you was one of my favorite things to work on, and it was the titles. What you'll notice when you watch the titles is it's the blood going backwards, the black and white look. You'll notice a couple of things about this image. Number one, we've got the blood being red and the skin being grey and dead and white, as a vampire would be. No sparkling in the sunlight for these vampires. These are actual vampires. Real ones. Eat your face off, vampires. Not, oh, I'm so angsty at the world, oh, kind of vampires, which we get in a film that I'm not going to name, Twilight, because that would be mean to that wonderful piece of filmmaking. So the other thing you'll notice as well is we've got a nice street light thing going on in the background here, a bit of an anamorphic lens flare, and the other two things you'll notice are, if I do a quick RAM preview of the whole thing, the fact that there's a lot of camera movement which wasn't present during the shooting. The whole thing was shot on a tripod. You'll also notice that the blood's moving backwards, and that the whole thing just has this really nice gritty feel to it. So we're going to look at how we created this. So let's give it a go, let's see what happens. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take my footage and I'm going to drag it into a new composition, like so. And there's a couple of things that we need to do before we start to do our visual effects. I need to pick my in and out points, because what we have here is over a minute where the poor, and we did this various different takes, various different angles, this poor woman had to kneel on the floor in front of this green screen and have freezing cold, like it was really cold, fake blood poured over her by the director, and he's just off shot with this big bucket of blood just pouring it on top of her, and we just want to find the exact points where we think the blood looks absolutely fantastic and edit those in. And I kind of know where I want it to be, and hey presto, I've gotten there straight away. I just want the beginning of the second bead to come down, so I'm going to set my in point there, and then I just want to see that second bead leave the shot. A little bit more this way. We only need about 6 to 8 seconds of footage. And I'm just going to set my out point, and I'm going to go to trim comp work area. We've got more than I need, so I'm going to trim it even further. I'm going to trim it down to about 10. Bring it just a little bit further in here. Okay, we've got a lot more than we need, but I find it's better to have too much than too little when it comes to the cut, because it gives me a little bit of leeway either way. So here we've got our shot, and the first thing we want to do is key out the green. I'm not going to use key light. I use Primatte Keyer, personally. A lot of people like key light. If you're looking for a tutorial on how to use key light, Video Copilot has some brilliant ones, and there's some great ones as well here on aetuts, some great green screening tutorials. Have a little look, and you'll find some great tutorials for using key light. I use Primatte because I enjoy using it more. It's about as simple as it is. So I'm just going to show you a quick, very, very quickly, how we use Primatte Keyer once we've selected it. Sampling style, I'm going to go for rectangle because I can see the broad scope of greens that I'm going to choose. And this is the good thing about Primatte Keyer, is that rather than picking one point and one green, and then trying to key the rest of the green as a result of that one color that I've chosen, I can actually I can grab a large sample of greens and tell the keyer this is the general area that I want you, color range that I want you to key. So I'm just going to come here where it's quite close, and then I'm going to drag a rectangle out and go boom. Oh my god, that looks dreadful! No! Don't worry, chill, don't panic, don't panic. Breathe, breathing is important. If you don't breathe, you die. What we need to do is we need to do a little bit of tweaking, okay? We're going to go to the view, and we're just going to hit matte, and I'm going to clean my background by then just selecting more of those greens. I'm just going to come a little bit closer. Oh, there it is, beautiful. And then I'm going to go into clean foreground, and I'm just going to do a nice big rectangle just to clean the foreground. And if I go back into the comp, we've got a really, really gorgeous key. It's a bit of a rough edge, and rather than using all of the refinement tools, which use up a lot of CPU and will slow down my tutorial, I'm instead going to go to matte choker, and I'm just going to apply some geometric softening. Oh, you see the key, it's beautiful. Keying is just a quick point of discussion here. How does it make you feel knowing how easy the technology is to use, whether it be Keylight or Primatte Keyer? How much does it annoy you when you see a bad key in a film? There's no excuse for it anymore. That's a nice key. So we're going to go on to now remove the skin tone and keep the red. Now here's the problem with using a keyer for this, and also the problem with using leave color, which is a really cool effect but has one fundamental flaw when keying red from skin tone, because what a color information does skin tone have? It has a lot of red in it. So if I just show you that really quickly by going to color correction, leave color, if I click on my red here and I bring it all the way up to there and I bring my tolerance all the way down to zero, even when I bring my softening up and I manage to get rid of it, even at a 3% edge softness, we still get some spillage of color, and we also get this really horrible kind of dark gray edge around, so we want to avoid that. So I was trying to figure this out, getting a little bit annoyed, thinking, great, I'm going to have to rotoscope blood. That's going to be an epic waste of time. I decided to give something a go, and I used an effect that we all use constantly, almost in every single composition that we do, and we use it for the same thing. And very few people, and you may be among the people who do, but very few people experiment with such a simple filter, because we're using it for the same thing over and over again. And I'm actually going to use color correction, hue and saturation. Okay. Now we use hue and saturation normally to desaturate completely, or to desaturate a single color. But what I'm going to do is do a quick two-step process that will desaturate everything that I don't want and saturate everything that I do want. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the master saturation. I'm going to bring it down to zero. I might not actually. I'm going to give it a little bit of a hue. There we go, just about that. And then I'm going to go to red, and I'm going to use the triangles and the rectangles here. What are they for? Well, simply, they allow you to choose the exact colors and color ranges that you wish to be affecting when you're desaturating or resaturating certain colors. And what that means is if I increase the width between these two, my color range will increase and more colors will be affected. When it comes to the triangles, what that's doing is it's allowing me to choose what colors are being faded into. So where is the feathering happening between two colors? And here, anything within the kind of late reds and early yellows are all going to be faded in. So if I was in fact to go up like this, you'll see that actually some of the skin tone starts to come back. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this and I'm going to bring it right in so that it's red There is no stipulation to any other color. The only color that I want affected is absolute red. I'm going to bring this all the way in and say there is no room for margin, no room for error, no room for any other color to get their ore in. And then what I do is I start to bring up the saturation, and I'm going to need to do it quite drastically. And you can see, boom, there we go, boom, done. The red is back, okay? There's a little teeny bit of red here, so what I'm just going to do is I'm going to go into my master and I'm just going to bring that down a tad. I'm going to go back into my red, I'm going to bring that up, and I'm probably going to need to bring these in just a little twidgy bit more. Okay, wonderful. We have a tiny little bit of colour in there. I did get rid of that through long amounts of tinkering. I'm not going to do any of that tinkering today, simply because we don't have time. I could literally sit here for an hour and tinker with this, but I'm not going to. So there. I'm just going to bring the lightness down just a tad to make that a nice deep looking red. Beautiful. One thing I'm going to do really quickly as well is I'm going to go to time, I'm going to right click on my layer, go time, and reverse the time layer so that now the blood will be traveling in the opposite direction. Just for the sake of quickness, I'm just going to bring this down to third so I can show you what we've done there. There we go, beautiful. Excellente, excellente. Some of you may have noticed as well, the corner here, the key's not great, but that I've left that on purpose because it's not going to matter by the time that we finish, because you're not going to see it. So once I've done that, I now need to go into Effect, Color Correction, and I'm going to go to Curves, and I'm going to just do a film curve just to bring some really nice contrast to the image, and you see how deep that red's become, and you see how pale this has become. And I might just go in and just add the tidgiest, itsy bitsiest bit of blue just to add that into the skin tone to give it that little extra something. Okay, and it really is just absolutely tiny amount. Oh no, that was too much and was pretty awful. Okay, wonderful. So now we have this really nice, and you can see now that the harsh light that I've used on the left here, and the shadow that I've used and the fill light that I've used here really add some really nice depth to the whole image. You can see the light kind of sparkling off of that really rich red. Oh, it's looking good. So what we're going to do next is we're going to go and apply our background and some light wrapping. So I've got this really nice image, Regular Jane Raining Light 6. I got this off Google, and I'm just going to come in and make it just a little bit smaller and just add it here. And I want it just to be behind the light, that main light, just to be behind to give this light source a little bit more sense. And I'm just going to blur that image nice and heavily. Gaussian blur, Gaussian blur, I don't know how to say it. Beautiful. Okay, so I'm going to go back into my top layer. I'm going to go to Effect, and I'm going to choose Key Correct, which is another plugin that I absolutely love. I'm going to go to Light Wrap. You can create your own light wraps, takes too long. Simply put, and I'm just going to choose Regular Jane as my background, bring my blur up, bring my width right up. You can start to see that color now affecting and bleeding in, and it just means that and I go to add, and it just means that light there has a little bit more color to it, so it makes sense that light a little bit more. Wonderful. So we're getting there. We're actually quite close. There's two more things we need to do. The first thing is we need to color correct the whole thing. But before that, I'm going to add my camera shake. Okay. Now, there's a brilliant technique for this. I don't use camera wiggle. I try my best not to use wiggle when it comes to adding camera shake to anything, because it's very, very inorganic, very, very robotic, very machine and mathematics driven. I wanted something more organic and flowy. And I learned a great technique over Andrew Kramer's website. Go and have a look at it. For those of you who recognize this technique, I am just kind of showing it to you. You can go over to his website, obviously, and have a look at it as well. But this is a really cool technique. And kudos, absolute kudos to Andrew Kramer. Genius. What I did is I videoed with my camera, just while everybody was off having sandwiches. I made a video of a fire alarm. It might actually help if I put the footage in to the composition. Amateur mistake number one. Amateur mistake number two, forgetting to turn on your camera. And I'm just going to put this to full. And this footage is of me handheld filming a fire alarm. And the reason was is because the reds and the blacks and the whites make it really easy to track. So I'm going to go to the beginning. I'm also going to create a new null object. I'm going to go to track motion on the fire alarm layer. Track motion, position and rotation. I'm going to come to the bottom corner here and I'm going to make a nice big area. Making a big area slows down the tracking process because it increases the amount the computer has to do. However, it makes your track more accurate. So I'm also going to track this area here, the arrow. Wonderful. And I'm just going to hit track forward. It's going to take a little bit of time, so I'm going to stop the recording, let it do its thing, and come back in a moment. And track. And as if by magic, it's done. Okay, so we finished our tracking now. All these tiny little squares show that everything's been tracked nicely. You can see that it holds pretty strong. So we're just going to apply that. We're going to go to the edit target. We're going to null 3 is already selected, and then we're just going to go to apply to the X and Y. Okay, and what that now means is my null object will be well and truly stuck to my image, and now I can get rid of that footage, and you'll see that the little square here, the null object, will kind of bounce around and move around and whatnot. So what we're going to do, we're going to go to the beginning of the composition, and we're going to pick whip, which is this little thing here. We're going to pick whip our footage to the null, and we're also going to pick whip our background to the null. What we do need to do is we need to make our footage a little bit bigger, not too big. Great, I've shot this on the Canon 7D, which means I've got a little bit of scope there. I can zoom in a little bit. I would say up to about 35% before you start to get any massive amounts of pixelation, and I'm not going to increase the size anywhere near that. It's probably only going to be about 5 or 6%, and I'm just going to hold shift as I just bring that in and then bring it just across a tad, which is why that bit on the side doesn't necessarily matter. So now if I just kind of go through, like I said, I do apologize for how slow. I'm just going to go down to quarter actually, so that I can work a little bit quicker. You can see that there's motion, and though I can't show you on this rendered version, I'm going to show you here. You can see the result of what I've just done there. You can see that it all kind of moves really nicely and organically. Wonderful. So we're doing well. We're getting pretty much to the end game. There it is there. Don't worry about anything showing at the bottom or at the top, because it's not really going to matter too much, because we will for the final thing, we do the final composition, also the final edit, I do put letterbox bars at the top and the bottom to give it a kind of anamorphic-y fake look, to make it look a little bit more cinematic. So the fact that at the top and the bottom you may get the footage kind of coming up a little bit, it doesn't necessarily matter. Kind of eyeball it yourself and decide what you think is appropriate. So what now we're going to do is go to New and Adjustment Layer, and we're going to apply our color correction. This is the final step of our process. So we're going to go to color. We're going to go to Effect, Magic Bullet Looks, and we're just going to. I'm going to pick a nice spot. It's important to pick a nice spot, just so you can see where everything there. That's what I mean there. That there's probably a bit unacceptable. So I'm going to bring that in. Okay, cool. Where was I? Yes, that was right. Color correction we're going to do on the adjustment layer. So let's go to the adjustment layer and open up Magic Bullet Looks. Hello, Magic Bullet Looks. How are you? And I've got here my footage. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to put on a basic color correction just to get a few of the things that I want onto the canvas. Okay, I'm going to remove that completely, and I'm going to start off with my curves adjustment. I'm just going to add a shed load of contrast. Wonderful. So that's a good start. Other things that we're going to do to this is I'm going to go into post, and I'm just going to add a telekinetic warm there, and I'm just going to bring the strength down a tad just to bring out the richness of some of those colors. I'm then going to go to matte gradient. I'm just going to bring it down here. I'm just going to add a little bit of blue here. I'm just going to bring that up. I quite like that. That's nice. And I'm then going to go into my lens. I'm going to add a quick vignette, and I'm going to make that nice and big, and I'm going to bring the fall off down so that it affects less of the image. Okay, it's looking good. What I'm also going to do is I'm going to add an anamorphic lens flare. At the moment it's blue, and I'm going to just change it to a nice orangey color. And I'm going to increase the softness of that. Beautiful. And just play around the boost. I think that's quite nice. Make it quite harsh, quite garish. I quite like that look for it. And for all intents and purposes, I think we're doing quite well. I just want to add maybe a twinge more blue into my diffusion there. Maybe not actually. Okay, that looks nice. I'm just going to hit finish. Wonderful. And you can see the change that that's made. A couple of other things that I did with this is I did work on the blues around this area and so on and so forth. I just wanted to show you really kind of generally how to create the effect that we wanted to create. So there we have it. It's thrown together really quickly. It took me a lot longer to create the final effects for the actual thing, but I really just wanted to show you the techniques that I use to create the effect itself. Have good fun, you know, doing this yourself. Maybe go and film your own footage, you know, with, you know, blood running down someone, and see if you can do something similar or just as cool. Maybe you want to give it a full-on Sin City look and you want to make everything black and white, in which case that'd be pretty cool. There's lots of really cool things you can use this technique for. One of the things I really got out of it was being able to draw out one color off of a background that is a similar color. And that was, in this respect, bringing the red off of the red tones of the skin. Hopefully you've enjoyed this tutorial, hopefully you've learned some cool stuff, and hopefully you'll be back for more tutorials from me. Until next time, I bid you farewell.